media has not reached that level of professionalism. They are not protected. Their families are not so much secured. They are not trained. It's not that if a journalist gets killed, he knows that for the rest of his life his family will be protected, or he'll get a pension, or he's got gratuity, or he got some financial resources and assets. So even the journalists are very shy. The level of professional competence, the salaries that they get are very low. And they don't have any professional respect if they die in the cause of duty. So the Pakistani journalists are still not mature enough or brave enough to go alongside their troops and serve and face the same kind of war which our soldiers are facing on ground. Army is more than willing to take them. So many times, if I want to go, I can go today. There's absolutely no problem. If I'm not going, I'm not going because I don't want to go. But so this is exactly for the media. If the foreign journalists and the foreign media want to be embedded with the army, want to go on the front line, I don't see any problem. But as far as I know, even in the heat of the battle, because it's so unpredictable, absolute counterinsurgency operations in which no side is giving any quarter, because Taliban are the most ruthless of opponents. They don't take prisoners. They slaughter them and make a video out of them, and then they broadcast that video also. So when this kind of environment is there, if any journalist is caught alongside the troops and the soldiers, he can be sure that his throat would be slit. So no journalist want to take this kind of risk. That is why the Pakistani media, so whatever is coming out, that is coming out through the refugees, that is coming out through the soldiers who are fighting, and of course the official channel which the army and the government want to release. In the modern age, there is so much of extra sources available, so much of side sources available. Like, our sources of information is mostly the soldiers and the officers who are fighting on ground, and they take pictures from their own cameras, from their own mobile phone, and quietly they bring it to us through unofficial channels. We have got pictures that Indian weapons are found there. We have got pictures that Indian soldiers are fighting in Sawat. They're captured, they've been killed, giving proof completely that they were not even Muslims. They were non-Muslim troops fighting against Pakistan army, and whose faces were like Uzbeks, whose faces were like Gurkhas, whose faces are flat. They were not Pakistani people. They were not Pakistani faces. Tehreek-e-Taliban was created by CIA after 9/11. During the time of President Musharraf, CIA took special permission from Musharraf to operate in Pakistani tribal areas under the pretext of hunting Osama bin Laden, under the pretext of finding Al-Qaeda elements. And instead of hunting Osama bin Laden, instead of finding Al-Qaeda elements, what the CIA did was they created their own terrorist assets of Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan with the sole objective of creating a wave of terror inside Pakistan. Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan never fights inside Afghanistan. The Afghan Taliban and the Afghan Mujahideen, Gulbuddin Hekmatyar and Jalaluddin Haqqani, they have condemned Baitullah Masood for waging a war against Pakistani state, for waging a suicide campaign against Pakistani people. But Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan never fights against Americans and the NATO inside Afghanistan. They have not done a single suicide bombing against NATO, but they have done over 200 suicide bombings against Pakistan. So whom are they working for? Where are they getting the weapon systems from? Where are they getting the money from? Where are they getting the satellite communication equipment from? Considering the fact that these militants have got sophisticated communication equipment, Indian weapon systems, alcohol, and things which would normally or ever would never be with Muslim Mujahideen, this is very clear. The Sawat insurgency in Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan is a terrorist outfit sponsored, backed, supported by the Indians. We have got pictures that Indian weapons are found there. We have got pictures that Indian soldiers are fighting in Sawat. They're captured, they've been killed, giving proof completely that they were not even Muslims. They were non-Muslim troops fighting against Pakistan army, and whose faces were like Uzbeks, whose faces were like Gurkhas, whose faces were flat. They were not Pakistani people, they were not Pakistani faces. And they were non-Muslims because they were not circumcised also. So we've got pictures, but at the official level, the government has not released them. But we've got them and we have made broadcast for the world to see. It's an open secret now that Indian weapons, Indian equipment, their fighters are present in fighting in Sawat Valley in few numbers, but as advisors, as consultants, as somebody who gives direction and money and equipment and guns, yes, they're there. So alternate sources are available and we know what's happening in Sawat. There is absolutely no confusion now. Even if the government tries to hide anything or the army tries to hide anything, we get information from alternate sources and we are pretty sure what's happening there. The terrorists are being taken out. The 5 years effort of terrorists, they had built their bunkers, tunnels, command and control centers, explosive labs and factories, everything has been destroyed. Their main body of cadre, the fighters, the militants have been killed. They have been pushed back at least 5 years. And the time which has taken, about 2 months of this operation, has already lapsed now while we speak. I think this is a very reasonable amount of time, considering the fact that fight was being done in built up areas, in mountains, in region and in terrain which was inaccessible to the regular armies. So special forces had to be used. It's the most daring and fascinating operation which has taken place in Sawat, and in minimum of time, the majority and the backbone of the militants have been broken. I'm pretty sure. The local Taliban, Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan, is ideologically 110% different from Afghan Taliban. For the simple reason, Tehreek-e-Taliban was created by CIA after 9/11. During the time of President Musharraf, CIA took special permission from Musharraf to operate in Pakistani tribal areas under the pretext of hunting Osama bin Laden, under the pretext of finding Al-Qaeda elements. And instead of hunting Osama bin Laden, instead of finding Al-Qaeda elements, what the CIA did was, they created their own terrorist assets of Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan with the sole objective of creating a wave of terror inside Pakistan. Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan, Baitullah Masood, never fights inside Afghanistan. The Afghan Taliban and the Afghan Mujahideen, Gulbuddin Hikmatyar and Jalaluddin Haqqani, they have condemned Baitullah Masood for waging a war against Pakistani state, for waging a suicide campaign against Pakistani people. But Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan never fights against Soviet, against Americans and the NATO inside Afghanistan. They have not done a single suicide bombing against NATO, but they have done over 200 suicide bombings against Pakistan. So whom are they working for? Where are they getting the weapon systems from? Where are they getting the money from? Where are they getting the satellite communication equipment from?
Strongly condemn this most brutal and horrible act of terror and violence.
When you make an operation in a built-up urban area, you have to realize that Sawat is not tribal areas. Sawat is a city. Sawat is a major Pakistani town valley. And there are hundreds of thousands of people living there. And whenever you do a military act operation in a built-up area, in a major city, the city gets destroyed, the people have to be migrated, and that would have been a major political upheaval. Finally, when the cancer of Taliban became at such a level that no further option were left, army was forced to ask the government to declare a war in Sawat Valley and ask the refugees to come out. So the population was evacuated, army had to go in, and it was a difficult operation because the terrorists were hiding amongst the cities. There's no defined front. You can't see the terrorists. There's no border areas. There's no front lines where you can fight. You have to go after valley to valley, house to house, take them out, and it takes a huge amount of time. They want to break Pakistan like they broke Yugoslavia. The man who broke Yugoslavia was Richard Holbrooke, who signed the Dayton Peace Agreement. And Richard Holbrooke is the man which the Americans have sent now to Pakistan and Afghanistan under a unified doctrine called the AFPAC. The AFPAC doctrine means that Pakistan is no more an American ally. Pakistan is a theater of operation just like Afghanistan is. And the NATO and the Americans have the right to operate in Pakistan just like they have the right to operate in Afghanistan. But the problem is that Pakistan is no Yugoslavia. In Yugoslavia, the Americans had no dependence on the Yugoslavian soil, on the Yugoslavian territory. Like, for example, Yugoslavia was not a nuclear power state, and American and NATO supply lines were not going through Yugoslavia. In Pakistan, Pakistan is a nuclear power state. We have got over 100 nuclear warheads which are spread over our various forces, Army, Navy, Air Force, Strategic Force Commands, and Americans don't even know where they are. And secondly, the NATO supply lines go through Pakistan. So if they move a bit fast in Pakistan, if the NATO tries to intervene, they're not sure how Pakistani armed forces are going to react. And secondly, the NATO supply line would be stopped. Then if the NATO supply line is stopped, the Americans in Afghanistan will be trapped like rats in cages, and they'll be slaughtered. And the fact of the matter is that they also know that Pakistanis have the will, potential, resource, and the emotions to do with the Americans what we did to the Soviets.
Tonight we are a country awakened to danger and called to defend freedom.
We must understand one thing, that after the 9/11, that the war that the Americans have waged in the name of war on terror is not a war against terror. It's a war to reshape the entire Middle East, the entire Muslim world, into geographic and ethnic lines. They need to draw new maps here. In the beginning of the 20th century, they waged the First World War, and after that they redrew the entire Middle East. The most sufferers of the First World War were not the Europeans, were the Muslims. The Muslim Khilafat Osmaniyah was broken down. The Muslim world was broken down into almost 50 states. The new maps were drawn of the Middle East. The maps that you see today were drawn after the First World War in the early 20th century. In the beginning of the 21st century, they need new maps. Now the maps they are talking about are drawn on ethnic lines, on blood borders as they call it. For example, in northern Afghanistan, northern Iraq, they want to make a Kurdistan region, taking out territory from Turkey, Iran, and Afghanistan and Iraq, turning it to a Kurd region. Similarly, in Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Iran, between them, they want to create a Baluch region. Similarly, in Afghanistan, they want to create a larger Pashtun region, taking out chunks of territory from southern Afghanistan right up to Pakistan's western regions.